This morning we are reading in the book of Matthew. No, reading in the book of Mark, I'm sorry. Book of Mark. Man. And we're reading in the book of Mark chapter 9. And we're going to, the part that we're starting from is chapter 9, verse 14. We're going to go from 14 through 29. And I want to give you some understanding of what's going on in here. But the name of the service this morning is called The Power of Prayer and Truth. Can you repeat that? Can you say the power, of prayer, and truth?
And truth.
Now, by the end of the service, we want you to understand what that's about so that you can apply it to your lives on a day-to-day basis. And so the story, what's going on at this time with the disciples is Jesus and three of his close disciples. Those disciples are Peter, James, and John, had just come back from the mountain experience. The experience that they call the Transfiguration, where on the mountain, Moses showed up and Elijah appeared, and Jesus was what they call transfigured. That means it showed the glory of who he really was, who he really is. And so Jesus appeared transfigured before them, and they were able to see the glory of God. So it was so amazing to them because he was shining and he was glowing. They said, you know, say even as white as can be, they were able to see the glory of God flowing from him. And so they had just come down from the mountain of experiencing that. Not all the disciples were able to experience that. There were only three of them who were entitled to experience the transfiguration of Jesus. And so they were a little astonished and kind of awed by who God was. And so they come down from the mountain, and when they reached, you think about it, they had left the other disciples. There's nine other disciples, and the other disciples had been given gifts. They have the ability to heal. They have the ability to remove demons. And so when they reached the other disciples, they saw them surrounded. They had a crowd around them because of the works. How many people know in here that you know, even when you're a man or a woman of God, when you serve God to the fullest, and whether people know it or not, sometimes people know, they see the anointing on your life. They know there's something different about you. Don't understand what it is, but it's always the Lord's work in your life, the Lord's work in your heart. And so when they reached the other disciples, they were surrounded by a large crowd. There was a large crowd around the disciples, and they were in the process of trying to heal this child. They were trying to heal a child, and the disciples remembered their experience in the power of God. They have the blessing that's been put upon their lives. And when you have a blessing that's like the power of God working in your heart, working in your lives, being able to rebuke spirits, people sometimes may mistake the blessing and they'll follow the blessing instead of the blessor. And so that's what's happening here. Sometimes they follow the blessing that's on your life. Sometimes they're around you because have you ever been around somebody who, no matter where you're around them, they always, positive things always happen to them? You ever been around that person? Man, it's always good stuff that happens to that person. Well, these disciples are able to remove spirits. And so if you've got demonic spirits that are dealing with the person, these disciples had the authority to remove those spirits. And so people were following them, not looking where the authority came from, but looking at the blessing that they had upon their lives. So these people were looking at the miracle workers instead of looking at where the miracles came from. And that was a big mistake they had with Jesus. They followed him because he could feed 5,000. They followed him because he had the experience of the blessing of walking on water. They could see him do miracles. They could see him do all those things instead of trusting who he was in God. So the people were expecting results because thus far they had received it. Every time Jesus healed somebody, the person was healed. Every time when the disciples got the authority, when the disciples would heal or remove a spirit, that spirit would come out. But not this time. So this time, starting from verse 14 to 15, it says, when they came to the other disciples. They saw the large crowd around them, and the teachers of the law were arguing with them. As soon as all the people saw Jesus, they were overwhelmed with wonder and ran to greet him. Not because he had just come off the mountain, not because he was glowing and the glory was seen when he was on the mountain, but no, because he was Jesus and he popped up on them. And they had just got finished experiencing something with the disciples, and there was an argument brewing. And so Jesus says, "What are you arguing with them about?" And a man in the crowd answered. "Teacher, I brought you my son." So first of all, he said, "I brought you my son." And so the disciples, write this down, disciples represent Jesus. Why is that important? Because a disciple is one who follows the teachings of another. So what does that make you? That makes you disciples if you trust in Jesus. And so what's happening here is the man said he brought you, meaning the disciples are representing Jesus. "I brought you my son, who is possessed by a spirit that has robbed him of speech. It says, whenever it seizes him, it throws him to the ground. He foams at the mouth, gnashes his teeth, and becomes rigid. I asked your disciples to drive out the spirit, but they could not." And so he uses specific thing by saying, I brought you my son, and I asked your disciples. So how many of us in here know that we represent Jesus Christ? And if you represent Jesus Christ, you want to represent him right. And so what's going on here is disciples were representative of Jesus. And the first question you want to ask or write down is, why couldn't the disciples heal the boy? Why couldn't they heal him? Because they had the power of God within them, because Jesus gave it to them. Write this down. It's in chapter 6, verse 7. Chapter 6, verse 7. In the same book of Mark, this is what it says. "Calling the 12 to him, he began to send them out two by two and gave them authority over impure spirits." So if that's the case, why were they hindered from restoring that child? Why were they hindered from removing that spirit? It's important that you understand that, because it involves you too. Because you are to be Christ-like, and you have to understand why these disciples had the abilities, because Jesus gave them the abilities, but on the other hand, they could not remove that spirit. So you gotta understand that, because it can involve you praying for somebody and trying to remove a spirit. So if they were given all the abilities, then why weren't they able to do this? It's important. That's the question that will help each and every one of us in our walk with Jesus Christ, in our walk in the Lord, in our walk with the Father. So it says in verse 19, it says, "You unbelieving generation." Wow, why is Jesus saying that? Is he talking to all the people around? No, he's speaking to who? The disciples. Why? Because he had just given them abilities, and they could not use the abilities because there was a reason behind it. So it's important that we understand, why is he calling them an unbelieving generation? Because they couldn't use the power of God. Verse 20, it says this. It says, "How long shall I put up with you? Bring the boy to me." And then he says, "So they brought him. When the spirit saw Jesus, it immediately threw the boy into a convulsion." So the spirit saw Jesus, saw the authority that Jesus had, knew that Jesus had the authority, and what happened immediately? He tried to take the boy out. Why is that important? Because when people see you, they see Jesus. When spirits see you, they see Jesus. When you walk by, whether you see them or not, they see Jesus in you. You have the same spirit. It's identical to the spirit of who Christ was and is. So whenever any demonic spirit, whether you can see them or not, sees you, all it sees is what you have in you, which is the Holy Spirit of God. Why is that important? Because they had the availability to heal and to restore, but they could not. And so the spirit comes and sees Jesus and tries to finish the boy off, tries to throw him into convulsion, tries to destroy the kid. Why? Because he wants the kid to not accept. He doesn't want to be removed from that kid. So if that's the question, why when the spirit, the demon spirit saw the disciples, he didn't see the same authority? There's a key here. And if we get that key, we can walk with the authority of Jesus. Or if we don't get the key, we can walk like the disciples did. So it's important that we understand this. Verse 21 and 22, it says, Jesus asked the boy's father, how long has he been like this? From childhood, he answered. It has often thrown him into fire or water to kill him. But if you can do anything, take pity on us and help us. See, the one thing you want to understand is he said, if you can do anything, as if Jesus was one of the disciples. So Jesus is like, what? He said, if you can do anything. He's kind of acting like Jesus was one of the disciples and Jesus couldn't, maybe able to heal the boy, instead of seeing the authority that Christ had. Why did he say that, if you can? Because of what the disciples could not do. So it's important that we understand what the disciples could not do. He lost faith in the disciples. So if he lost faith in the disciples, guess who else he also lost faith in? Jesus. Why is that important for us? Because if people lose faith in you, who represent Christ, guess who else they're going to lose faith in? If they see you doing things of the world, guess who else they're going to lose faith in? You got to understand who you are as Christians, as people who walk in Jesus Christ. The things you used to do, now that you're proclaiming Christ, you can't do. You can't drink like you used to drink. Say amen, amen.
Amen.
Say a long time ago, everybody.
Long time ago.
Long time ago. You can't do all those things you used to do and expect to walk in Christianity. You have to change. And the disciples lost focus on what they were doing. But because the man couldn't trust the disciples, he couldn't trust Jesus either. He was saying, well, if you can do something, if you have the authority, if you have the power. And so you have to recognize that you are the disciples also. It says, from childhood, and then it says, if you can, Jesus says, if you can, and now he's asking the question, what do you mean if you can? He said, everything is possible for one who believes. How many of y'all understand that everything is possible for one who believes? Let's say it all together. Everything is possible for one who believes. What does that mean? Why is that important? Because you have to recognize that we are just the vessels of God. We do the works of God. People shouldn't have trust or faith in the vessel. We should be directing them to the source, not the vessels. And when you direct them to the vessels, when the vessels fall short, they look at the vessels as Christ himself. So it says here, in verse 24, it says, immediately the boy's father exclaimed, I do believe, help me overcome my unbelief. Now, how crazy does that sound? I do believe, but help me overcome my unbelief. How many people think that's funny, right? Isn't that funny? He said, I do believe, but help me overcome my unbelief. Now, has anybody ever said that before? No, none of y'all in here have ever said that, right? Y'all never said that I believe in you, Christ, except in this area. Anybody ever said that? I trust you, Lord. I trust you with everything. I put my trust in you, Father, until it comes to my finances. Anybody ever said that before? I trust you, Lord. I trust you, Lord, until it comes to my relationship. I trust you, Lord, until it comes to my job. I trust you, Lord, until it comes with all that I have. I can't give everything up. I trust you, but not in this era. We all say that we are just like that man sometimes, confessing that we have faith. But then in certain areas, you're like, well, I don't know about this area. And so We're here to change that. We're here to change that because any of those areas will do. Any of those thoughts will do. And so verse 25 says this. Verse 25 says, when Jesus saw that the crowd was running to the scene because they were looking for him, he rebuked the impure spirit. You deaf and mute spirit, he said, I command you, come out of him and never enter him again. It says, the spirit shrieked, convulsed him violently, and came out. The boy looked so much like a corpse that many said, he's dead. But Jesus took him by the hand and lifted him to his feet, and he stood. Everybody say amen.
Amen.
And so here is the important part of what we're learning today. We can talk about rebuking spirits and all that other stuff, but that's not the important part of what we need to learn today. What we need to learn as Christians, as people who walk in Jesus Christ, is why they couldn't do what they were supposed to be able to do. Jesus gave them authority, so that meant that when they went to that child, they should have been able to remove that spirit. So we want to learn why it's what's so important. And so it says here in verse 28, it says, after Jesus had gone indoors, his disciples asked him privately, why couldn't we drive it out? We had the same authority. Why couldn't we drive out the spirit? We had the same authority. You gave us the authority. He replied, this kind can come out only by prayer.
Amen.
So wait. I need you to understand this because in order for us to connect with the Father and the Son, we have to know what that meant when Jesus was saying it only comes out by prayer. Is he saying that the disciples were not praying? Is he saying the disciples were not trusting in God? Well, kind of, yes and no. Why weren't they able to use the abilities that Jesus gave them? See, I want you to understand that without Jesus being there, Jesus was on the mountain. And so Jesus wasn't there. And without Jesus being there, they had to work and live by the faith in God the Father. What did Jesus do when he was there? Everything he did was based on the Father. So now Jesus left them. They don't have Jesus there to heal. And so they've been given the authority. So what do they have to do? They have to trust in what? The Father. How do you trust in the Father? You can only trust in the Father one way, not by being a miraculous healer. You're able to touch people and they be restored. But you can only do that by prayer. The Father is spirit. And so what they did is they lost focus. They got focused on the abilities that they had, the abilities that was given to them, and lost focus on why they were given the abilities and who they were given it through. Without Jesus being there, the disciples had to work and live by the Father. The faith was not obtained by healing. The faith was obtained by worship. How do you worship God? Well, I want you to write this scripture down, because our worship of God is obtained in two ways, and I want to express that, and it's expressed in John 4:24. It reads, God is spirit, and his worshipers must worship him in spirit and in truth. To worship him in spirit and truth, the disciples, they lost their focus on worshiping him in spirit. The only way to worship him, the only way to have strength is through prayer. You can only have strength through God the Father in prayer. You can only worship him in spirit. What is spirit? What is worshiping him in the spirit? Worshiping him through prayer. And in truth is the other important thing. And in truth. In truth, their focus should have been the Father through the Son, because truth represented in the book of John is always related to Jesus. So if you're going to worship him in spirit and in truth, you have to worship him in prayer using the truth that you've learned through Jesus. So how is that? How do we apply that to our walk? How do we become more structured in what we do as Christians? You can't have one without the other. You should be praying to the Father according to the truth that you're learning through the Son. Every time you learn truth to the Son, you don't want to pray haphazardly. You want to pray with what you've learned in Christ Jesus. If you are not learning truth, then what are your prayers about? If you pray to God, God, I want a car, I want this, I want that, I want all this money, I want this and that, and that, and that's not truth, what are your prayers about? You're not going to see God. The enemy is an imitation of God. You'll see him. But you want to see God, you've got to pray in spirit and in truth. You've got to pray to God the Father through the Son, through what you learned about the Son. How do you worship just spirit and not truth? How do you worship just spirit and not truth? Well, you worship by praying, but you know nothing about the truth of Jesus Christ. How do you worship with just truth and not spirit? You worship with truth without, and not spirit by trusting Jesus but not praying to the Father. They're intertwined. You can't have one without the other. If you go to the Father and say, Father, I trust in you, but your Son, I'm going to leave alone. He's going to say, well, I am the Son. Me and the Son are the same. You can't pray to me. You can't come to me except through Christ. Because if you come to me, you come to me with all your sins. If you come through Christ, you come white as snow. Then I'm willing to listen to you. And you can go to Jesus and say, Jesus, I trust in you because you're here. I see all the miracles, but I don't want to pray to you. I don't know nothing about that, Father. Well, Jesus said, me and the Father are one. We're the same. So if you can't come to the Father, you can't come to me. And so you can't worship in just truth, and you can't worship in just spirit. You have to worship in spirit and in truth. And the only way to do that is to intertwine them, to pray to the Father, but use what you've learned about the Son. Why is it important to come to church? Because you learned the Scripture. Why does he want you to learn the Scripture? Because the Scripture is truth. And when you go to the Father, you have to go to the Father spiritually, but in truth, what Jesus says. So we have to ask ourselves this. How much are we keeping ourselves in the nature of God? How much are we praying? How much are we trusting God? That doesn't mean you're getting down on your knees 20 times a day, but how many times are you conversating with God, saying, God, help me with this. Help me in this situation. God, I need your direction before I go here. God, I trust in you. Or how many of you are doing this? God, your word says, Jesus says this. I learned this in church today. God, I learned that I should forgive 7 times 70. God, I should forgive unlimited, but I'm not. Please help me with this. Now you're praying in spirit and you're praying in truth. How much are we keeping ourselves in the nature of his truth? How much are we keeping? See, we can pray to God 1,000 times a day. But not touch him, because we're not praying in truth. We say, God, I love you. Well, he says, if you love me, follow my Son. But I'm not following your Son. So either we love him, and our evidence of loving him is following the Son and learning the Son's ways, or we don't love him at all. You love him by the actions. Faith without works is dead. Works is following the Father through the Son. So truth is always associated with Jesus Christ. We weaken the power the Lord permits us to have when we operate in the flesh instead of the truth. The disciples lost their faith in prayer and trusted only the gift that Jesus provided them. Jesus gave them a gift to be able to restore, remove spirits. He gave them authority. And so they got caught up in the authority. They were surrounded by a bunch of people saying, man, these guys are good. And they were like, yeah, we in the name of Jesus, come out, do this, do that. But they forgot that they had to focus on the Father, because the authority was given through the Father, by the Father, through the Son. So you have to intertwine both of those. You have to stay in prayer, but you also have to understand what Jesus wanted for your life. Because what Jesus wants for your life is true, and what the Father wants is spirit. You can't worship the Father except in spirit. God, thank you. Your word says that no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I thank you for that, Lord. I'm not going to let this circumstance get in my way. Lord, your word says that greater is the one that is in me than the one that is in the world. I trust this Holy Spirit over this circumstance I'm dealing with. Look, that's how you pray in the Spirit. That's how you trust God. That's what we should all be doing. Lord, we learned today that the disciples couldn't heal because they were focused on their flesh and the ability that they was given instead of focused on you. Lord, allow, please don't allow me to ever stay focused on the world and not you. Lord, I trust you. When we don't do that, when we stay only attached to one and not the other, we weaken ourselves. And so the disciples lost faith in prayer and only trusted the gift that God had given them, which made them unable to remove the demon from that boy. Our power comes through faith in prayer to the Father and consistent learning of the truth. They're intertwined. The more you learn the truth, the more you're able to, the more you have in your tool shed to pray to God. You trust God with his own words. He said that his words do not come back to him void. They accomplish all that they're set out to do. So it's important as a Christian that you hold God accountable to his own words. Lord, you said you would never leave me. You said you would never forsake me. Why do I feel so lonely at this moment? Can you help me to operate in my spirit? Can you help me to operate in truth? Lord, I'm frustrated. I got all this going on, but I ask that you help me because your scripture says, greater is you that is in me. Mm-hmm. So, our power comes through faith and prayer to the Father and consistent learning of the truth. So some of you say, I've been praying and praying and praying, but nothing has happened. But are you praying truth? Or are you just praying? Are you talking to God? Or are you talking to God with his word? Sometimes we talk to God, but we don't talk with his word. And you're learning it every single week you show up. You're learning it every Bible study. You study the word. You're learning it when we come together as a family. But are you using it? Are you praying in spirit and in truth? Write this down. Learn more of the truth about Jesus this year. Pray by what you know is true. We used to have a saying back in the long time ago where it's talk what you know, let the rest go. When you talk to the Lord, you don't want to babble. You don't want to be, especially if you're coming to service learning the word of God. You don't want to babble. You want to talk truth and know that when you talk, that the authority that you have in you because Jesus Christ has given it to you is being useful. Can I get an amen? How many people in here want to be effective when you talk to God? When you go before the throne of God, when you bow down on your knees in your bathroom, in your kitchen, wherever you are, you know that God is hearing you because you are using the word of God.
Amen.
You want that authority. Every one of you in here has it. But you got to use it. You got to use it every step you take, every time you talk to God, you got to go before him saying, look, your word says, hold him accountable to his word because it never comes back to him void. Lord, you said you'll always be with me. You'll never forsake me. Lord, you said you will not be moved by anything else. You said that nobody can take you out of your hands. Nobody can rip you away. Why do I feel like Satan is tearing me apart from you? You said that you would always be with me. You said that you got to hold God accountable. He wants you to do that because his word never comes back void.
Amen.
Sometimes as Christians, we fall short by not doing that, by not using the word of God. So, pray by what you know is true and know that when you do that, you are worshiping God. You are worshiping the Father. And when you are worshiping the Father, the gates of hell can't prevail. Why? Because they don't have authority there. So is that important? Of course it is. You cannot worship the Father without the truth of the Son. They are intertwined. You want to get closer to the Father. How many people in here want to get closer to the Father?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Say that real loud. Say amen.
Amen.
You get closer to the Father through the Son. The more you learn about the Son, the more you understand what He wants you to do with faith, the more you can't. You know, what does the scripture say? It's impossible to what? Please God without faith. See, you got to know that. You got to know that it is impossible to please God without faith. And so how do we operate in faith? So what does that mean? When you go to God wondering why He hasn't shown you anything, why He hasn't appeared in front of you, you have to understand that you can't please Him without faith. If He appeared in front of you, you wouldn't need to have faith. And so He gives you abilities.
We have faith, there's life.
But you have to operate in those abilities. Power of prayer comes through truth. You pray as you learn truth. Look, when I was early in Christianity, I didn't know all the scripture. But the church I was at was telling me, well, you got to pray according to the scripture. Use the words of God. And so the only scripture I knew, true story, is no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I used that scripture over and over again in every circumstance. Even, you know, true story, when I was playing racquetball, I would use that. Went to state finals. Use that. Sitting there talking to myself on the court, playing a guy. Got mad at me. He wanted to fight me. But I was using the word of God. I just kept talking to myself. He got mad at me. I kept saying, no weapon formed against me. They probably thought I was crazy. Every time I would get up to serve and play, I would say, no weapon formed. He kept saying bad words and cursing and getting mad and everything. I kept saying, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. And they probably wondering what I'm saying. I just kept saying, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. I would not give in to what he was saying. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I don't know all about that scripture. I don't understand it wholeheartedly. I just know that the Lord says, no weapon formed against me shall prosper. And I was able to overcome the attack. And I told y'all this story before. That person who I got into it with came to me a year later and apologized for what he did. Yeah. I didn't even remember him that next year. Didn't even remember him. But he came up to me. He was looking for me. Because you know what happened all after that racquetball tournament, which I won by. I just want y'all to know that I did win. What I understood was after that racquetball tournament, I forgot about the guy. Went on with my life. But God dealt with it after that. Because I never said another thing to the man. I never cursed him. I never fought him, which if you know anything about me, years ago, it'd been a little different. It'd been all kinds of stuff on that racquetball court. I'd been ejected, rejected, and all that other stuff. Dang, I didn't talk to myself. Anyways, that gentleman, after he got out of that racquetball tournament, thought about it the whole year and was hoping I would be there. And I showed up and didn't know him from anybody else. He walked up, he said, you remember me? No, I don't. We played last year and I kind of said some things. Oh, okay, yeah, I do remember you. It was like, but hey, hold up, man. I do remember you now. He said, I just want to apologize. I'm so sorry for what I did. Changed my heart, just amazing. But it lets me know what our Lord God Almighty does when we put our trust only in Him.
Yep.
You have to understand the power of prayer and truth, because when I got out of that tournament, I prayed for him. I said, God, I don't understand. And even on that court, I remember saying to him, look, I forgive you. I forgive you for whatever you're saying to me. I forgive you of all that stuff you're saying. Didn't even give in to what he was saying. So I'm telling you this, the power of prayer and truth. I used the word of God. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. I prayed for him. The Lord says, pray for your enemies. Lift them up. Pray for them. Why? Because God prayed for you. God forgave you for everything you've done wrong. There's no way you can go to hell because God has given you eternal life with him. For that alone, you should pray for every enemy you have. You should pray for every person who does you wrong. You should not hold anything against anybody. We have work to do. And that work is trusting in God. You want to get closer to the Father, you get closer to the Son. And you do that through prayer of what you learn about God. You have to give God all that you have. You have to say things like, God, I'm giving because I have faith in the one I give to. God, I'm giving out of my finances because I just trust you, Lord. Look, we can't trust, who thinks you can trust banks and who thinks you can trust people and trust everything? You can trust God. He's there for you. He does it. He knows things before you know them. He knows all things. And he said, I'm with you. I have your back. So the least we can do is trust him with all that we have. You pray as you learn the truth. And you have to say things like, God, I'm forgiving my family, not because they've done something right, but because you've done everything right. You've forgiven me for everything I've done wrong. So I can forgive them, even though they don't deserve it. Amen?
Amen.
BKM, Blessed Kingdom Ministries, will not sway. We will pray and we will learn the truth all the days of our lives in Amen. This church.
Amen.
I'm not interested in growing thousands of people unless God wants to bring them.
Amen.
I'm not interested in screaming and jumping around and doing things to draw more people in or singing a great song because I couldn't do it anyway. But anyway, I'm not interested in doing that if it's not the work of God. So as a ministry, we have to come in here ready to learn the word of God, ready to understand it. I'm not interested in you leaving here and not understanding the word of God. We have to know that our prayer is powerful, but we have to use the right words. God, I trust you because I read the scripture and it says this. God, you said you'll never do this. Why is this happening? God, this spirit is dealing with me, trying to influence me, but I know I can't have a spirit in me because I have the Holy Spirit in me. Therefore, I ask that you remove that spirit. Look, you gotta know what to say.
Amen.
You gotta know what to say. Trust God. Sometimes we have spirits around us that are influencing our household, and because we've never used the word of God and asked them to leave, look, Jesus said, you deaf, mute spirit, I command you to come out in the name of Jesus and never enter him again. So Jesus said that, Lord, I don't understand this all, but I know that I have the same spirit in me that Jesus had. So I command that spirit, whatever, look, you got to know how to talk to the enemy and tell him to leave you alone. Sometimes he stays in your house because you never asked him to leave. Man, I don't know what's going on. You're talking to me, talking to everybody. Look, have you ever said leave?
Yes.
Have you ever used scripture?
Yes.
Jesus commanded, therefore, you have the Spirit of God. Use the authority of God. I don't know what's going on with my wife. She's acting up. How many times have you prayed about her?
Amen.
My husband's acting. How many times have you prayed over him? Stop looking for all the other stuff. You have the authority. Stop acting like a disciple. Amen?
Amen.
So for us as Christians, we have to know that we have in us the same spirit that Jesus had. The same spirit that allowed him to, that allowed the disciples to be able to rebuke spirit. The same spirit that allowed them to be able to do the miracles of God. We have that spirit in us. Now we get gifts from God. Whatever the gift is, you've got to enhance that gift. How do you enhance that gift? By knowing who your Lord is, by knowing who the Father is, and by using the scripture of God and understanding it. It's really that simple. The more you understand, the more you have to use. You don't have to have all and understand this all. You just have to know simple things. Well, God, you said, not operating haphazardly, but operating in the word of God. And when you do that, God listens. God, forgive me of all my sins. I don't know what I've done wrong. I don't know the sins I've done. I don't understand everything, Lord, but I ask that you forgive me. Now, Lord, can we talk about this situation I have? I know you know the situation, Lord, but I'm asking for your help. You said you would never leave me, so I'm asking that you help me in this situation. I don't understand it all, but you do. You knew I was going to be here. Lord, I have faith in you. I've been given into your kingdom because I trust you. Not that I'm looking for anything in return, but because I trust you. Lord, I'm having financial trouble. I need your help. See? See, that's how he works. He always shows up when you're doing his works. It does not come back to him void. Meaning what he says always happens. They couldn't heal because they were not operating in the spirit. They were operating in the popularity. When they got back to operating in the spirit, they were able to do those works again. You want to learn how to do the works of God? Operate in the spirit and in truth. One, both together, intertwined. Let's say it together. Operate in the spirit.
Operate in the spirit.
Operate in the truth.
Operate in the truth.
You're together. If you do that, every situation that you deal with will be overcome by the blood of Jesus.
Amen.
Every one of them. I'm not promising you. I'm guaranteeing you that. Why? Because the spirit that is in you is the spirit of God.
Amen.
It does not fail. And if it's failing, if you feel that it's failing, it's because you, it's something in you, not in the Word of God. Because the Word of God does not fail. Anytime I'm feeling anxious, anybody ever felt anxious before?
Amen.
I know that anytime when I start to get the anxious feeling, I know that the Spirit of God is not that anxious feeling. So if I start to feel anxious and walk in anxiousness, I'll call either one of my brothers in Christ or I'll start praying and honoring God and using the Word of God. And immediately, every time I do that, that spirit that tries to intertwine with me leaves.
Amen.
And what I'm telling you is if you just focus on God and trust in Him, the power of prayer and truth will never fail. Can you give God a round of applause this morning? Amen.